see if just ask people if they wanted to join us. Let's see, give them 10 seconds. See if people. So, welcome everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. It's my first of these seminars. My name is Thomas Lena. I'm new to New York and new to the New York Genome Center. So it's great to be here. It's a great pleasure to introduce Dr. Nelson Freimer from UCLA, where he is a distinguished professor of psychiatry and genetics. He's also the director of the Neurobehavioral Genetics Center and the director of the UCLA Grant Depression Challenge. I've known Nelson for many years. He's one of the most eminent geneticists in the field of neuropsychiatry. Nelson has been working with me and others on very large projects during my tenure at NIMH. And he's one of the first scientists, really, who expanded the research into the genetic architecture of mental disorders, particularly bipolar and depression, into non-Caucasian, ethnically diverse populations. Pleasure to have him here. And Nelson will tell us about his work in Colombia with an O.
Definitely Columbia with an O. So thanks, Thomas, and it is actually really nice to be here. I've never been at New York Genome, even though I've interacted with people from New York Genome for some time, and so it is really great to be here. So I'm going to talk about this project that we've been embarked on for a few years in Columbia, which we call the PISA Project. I'll explain why in a moment. And really, there are three motivations for this project. The first motivation, which is actually the last that I'm going to talk about, is our interest in genetic investigation of severe mental illness across diagnoses, as opposed to the sort of traditional way that it's been done, which is taking each diagnosis on its own. And I'll explain the reasons why we believe severe mental illness really needs to be investigated in this transdiagnostic way. The second motivation is that it offered us the opportunity to do large-scale investigation of severe mental illness in a population isolate. I've been interested in the really great advantages of doing genetics in population isolates for decades. And for severe mental illness, this particular population has tremendous advantages, which I'll talk about. And then the third motivation is the goal of increasing the representation of Latin American populations in psychiatric genetic research. And that's where I will actually start. I think anyone who has followed the field of psychiatric genetics could really say that over the last 5 to 10 years, we've gone from having no successes to really having marked success. And the Psychiatric Genomics Consortium, Schizophrenia GWAS studies really, I think, illustrate the success of this field when we're able to develop really large-scale projects. The consortium, at the time when I made this slide, I think this is already out of date, had over 60,000 cases. At that point, had 155 genome-wide significant sites. I think it's now over 300. And again, I think considering that 10 years ago we knew nothing about the genetics of any psychiatric disorder, really is really remarkable how quickly things have changed. But the thing that hasn't changed is that, as in human genetics overall, non-European ancestries remain very poorly represented in psychiatric genetics cohorts. And so this slide really illustrates this. So this is a graph showing the percentages of the world's population by different ethnicities. And as you can see here, European ancestry individuals represent about 16% of the world's population, but they represent 96% of the samples that have been included in psychiatric genetics consortium studies. The other 4% were from East Asian populations. And what you can see from this is that all of the other ancestry populations of the world don't even register on this kind of graph. And this poor representation, particularly in our view of Latin American ancestries, is striking given that these ancestries are not just important worldwide, but are the fastest growing ethnicities in the US. And so, so for example, in LA County where I live, individuals of Latin American ancestry will, by 10 years from now, not be just 40-something percent of the population, but will be the clear majority of the population. So the fact that we don't really know anything about their genetic risk is really something which is, you know, something that requires changing very rapidly. And it's not just from the standpoint of discovery, but there's really an important element to which this lack of representation has exacerbated existing health disparities. This is just a graph from a recent paper from Alicia Martin et al. In Nature Genetics, showing the degree to which polygenic risk scores can predict individual risks for disease. And if you take Europeans, you know, which are most of the studies that have been done so far, as a reference point, what you can see is that the polygenic risk scores derived from Europeans really for other ancestry populations are really giving very poor representation of individuals' risk of disease. So that's really the motivation that sort of drives interest in Latin American cohorts to start with, but I'm going to try to talk about what specifically drives our interest in this particular population, the Paisa population of Colombia, and our genetic studies in this very, very large genetic isolate. It may be the largest population genetic isolate in the world with about 9 million people. The isolation is a result of the historic inaccessibility of this region. This is just showing the beautiful mountainous countryside of this region, which occupies a sort of swath in the middle of Colombia. This is showing Colombia, the map of South America, and the Paisa region in Colombia is this region of northwestern Colombia, which is also the coffee region of Colombia. And it remained isolated because the two branches of the Andes Mountains are to the east and west, and so this area was inaccessible for a long time. However, in the late 19th and 20th centuries, it became a very highly populated area, centered in the city of Medellin, but also with many other cities, again, largely driven initially by the growth of the coffee economy. And so, you know, you might ask yourself, why do we consider it so important to conduct large-scale genetic studies of complex traits in a population isolate? I think everybody knows the reasons for why people did genetic studies of rare Mendelian diseases in population isolates, where you were likely to have a much higher frequency of recessive alleles because of the population structure. But why do we consider it something useful in this era of complex genetics? And that's really what I want to spend the next few minutes talking about. And I think you might go back and ask yourself, given the interest that we and almost anyone else in the field has in discovering not just the very low penetrance common variants that are identified by GWAS studies, but variants of higher penetrance that are lower in frequency and that are really the raison d'etre of places like New York Genome Center and many others that hope to use sequencing to have an impact on disease understanding. You know, I think all of us have now learned that that it's going to take very large samples to really achieve the promise of identifying these variants. And so really we asked ourselves several years ago, given that, you know, we don't yet have the kind of samples that we would like to have for sequencing of common diseases or other complex traits, is there a way that we can actually identify these kind of variants right now? And I'll just take a minute to talk about sort of the hypotheses that lead to the idea that large population isolates like the one I just mentioned in Colombia are really the ideal setting for doing this kind of work. And so what you can think of that is occurring in population isolates that have essentially formed from an initial founder population and then gone through population bottlenecks is that by chance there will be a much more restricted gene pool in those individuals who've come out of the bottleneck. So if you think this is the founding population, the bottleneck exists, the population begins to grow, and in the new population, you have the chance of a relatively small number of variants reaching a much higher frequency than they were in the founding population, or by extension in the sort of large heterogeneous continental populations that they've come from. And so we sort of have, I think at this point, best illustrated these phenomena in Finland. It's probably the most studied such isolate. It's a very large isolated population, a population of over 5 million. It has undergone several different bottlenecks, both the bottleneck at its founding more than 2,000 years ago in what's called the early settlement region, and then subsequent bottlenecks that occurred as the northern and eastern parts of the country were settled beginning in around the 16th and 1700s. And so I'm just gonna talk for a couple of minutes about a study that I was involved with involving sequencing of large samples from Finland and really what that has taught me about the sort of the advantages of this kind of population. So again, Finland started with this small founding population, went through a series of bottlenecks, and like many other populations, and in particular many isolated populations as shown here, the population of Finland, which is here the black squares, underwent very rapid expansion beginning around 1600 and 1700s. Most of this expansion, again, as is in most of the world, occurred in the post-industrial era. And you can see in Finland, this involved a growth from about 250,000 people in the year 1750 to about 5.3 million people today. And so this sort of history led to the hypothesis that I think has now been demonstrated very conclusively for Finland, that deleterious variants that pass through the bottlenecks may remain at higher frequency than in most other populations. And this is from a paper from Lim et al. From about 5 years ago, which again demonstrated that among the different variants that we see in Finland comparing the Finnish population to other European populations that are below this dotted line, that the particular enrichment in Finland is greatest for the most deleterious variants, again, because of the fact that this bottleneck phenomenon occurred and some of these variants reach very high frequency and haven't really had a chance to be selected against as they have been in most other European populations. And so I was involved in a project, which is called the FinMetSeq project, that involved exome sequencing of 20,000 people from these late settlement regions of Finland, again, the ones that have been the most bottlenecked. And we analyzed 64 quantitative traits that are relevant to cardiometabolic diseases in this study. And what we found, and this is now published, I don't have the reference here, I'm sorry, I neglected it. It was published in Nature last summer, was really a massive enrichment in Finland of deleterious variants with novel associations to one or more of these quantitative cardiovascular related traits. And what this slide shows is essentially the frequency in other European populations of these deleterious variants, which are associated at a highly significant level in this Finnish sample, and which have a much higher frequency in Finland than in these other populations. And this is true both in the 20,000 exomes that we sequenced in our study, as well as in larger Finnish populations in which we did meta-analysis with the one that we did. And you know, what was really remarkable is some of these variants are present at 100 or more frequency excess in Finland compared to non-Finnish Europeans. And really, I think what we concluded from this is that to get equivalent power in the European population in general would really require up to millions of samples. And so, you know, I think ultimately, obviously, we will get to millions of samples sequenced in European populations, North American populations, and so forth. But what it really told us is that in a population like Finland, with a sample of, let's say, in the tens of thousands of now, we could actually get the same kind of results that we're hoping to get in the future from these much larger populations, you know, as in the All of Us study or, you know, similar projects in other countries. And this is really, this experience from Finland was really a large part of what motivated this project in Colombia. And I'll get to that in 1 second. The other last thing I want to say about the Finnish example, because it does really have relevance to what I'm going to tell you about in Colombia, is, and you know, and this is something that's not surprising, is that what we found is that these variants that are associated with quantitative traits in Finland are not sort of uniformly distributed across Finland. They tend to be very geographically localized. And what was really surprising to us is it's been known for some time, anyone who knows anything about Finnish genetics knows about the Finnish disease heritage, which is a series of 30-something rare recessive diseases that are much more frequent in Finland than in other European populations. And this is what led to really the sort of incredible successes of positional cloning in Finland from Leena Peltonen's group in particular, but other groups as well, where before we had genomic tools, many of these disease genes were found. And what was known from the Finnish disease heritage diseases is that there was really very striking geographic clustering of cases. And again, that's not that surprising. Let's imagine that this is a recessive disease. It's not that surprising that you're more likely to find, you know, two individuals who are each carrying a recessive allele getting together in a narrow geographic region. And what really surprised us is that the level of geographic clustering for these quantitative traits was really as strong as it was for the Finnish disease heritage. So so again, if you look at carriers of the Finnish disease heritage alleles or these quantitative trait alleles in our project, you can see their clustering compared to non-carriers. It's really, you know, extremely obvious. So what interested me about the PISA population from the standpoint of this kind of approach is that it's another population isolate that formed through multiple different bottlenecks. So there was initial bottleneck in the foundation of this population. Again, you have these two mountain ranges here, and so the only habitable area was in this sort of internal valley. And the city of Medellin in Antioquia was founded first, and then over time, the rest of this region became populated. So each of these founding city, each of these are cities of actually several hundred thousand people. Each of these represents an additional bottleneck compared to the one that founded the country in the first place. And again, as in Finland, the population of this region has expanded very rapidly, in fact, even more recently than that of Finland. And we can see evidence of the degree to which there is this kind of isolation. A paper that we published in the American Journal of Human Genetics a couple of years ago, which showed that that this population actually had the highest level of homozygosity in terms of lengths of genome in regions of homozygosity of any of the populations that we had analyzed. This is Finland by comparison. This is the general European population. And probably the reason for this is the combination of both the genetic isolation of this population and the very high levels of consanguinity that they practiced there for a very long time. Another thing that differentiates this population from that of Finland is that that it really is an example of a population that formed by very sudden admixture, formed between the Native American population, which was very small number of Spanish colonists, and over a fairly short period of time, you developed this this single admixed population that's sort of represented in this painting. And so you know, this is what led us to undertake this project, the PISA project, which aims to be a comprehensive genetic investigation of severe mental illness in this population. I'll talk more about severe mental illness in a minute, but I wanted to first talk a little bit about the population isolate aspect of it. But the sort of the basics of this study, it's a study of 8,000 individuals with severe mental illness identified from electronic health records, mostly from a single hospital in the city of Manizales, which is the only city for a region of about 1 million people in the heart of this region. There are extensive phenotypic assessments, which I'll talk about in a moment. And so far, the only genotyping done is SNP genotyping, but I want to just talk about one result from the SNP genotyping, which we consider essentially a proof of concept finding that sort of leads us to believe that, our hypothesis that this population will be like the Finnish population is likely to be correct. And so what we have done in an initial genotyping of just the first 1,000 cases and controls is replicated very strongly a published GWAS finding for severe mental illness, again, in a very small sample. So we did association analyses of the individuals with severe mental illness in this population that we've studied so far. Again, it's a very small subset of the study. And we didn't want to look, you know, do a de novo GWAS because we obviously had no power to do that. But we thought, you know, just for fun, let's look at the loci that were significant from the large consortium GWAS of the different disorders that are represented here, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and major depressive disorder. One of the findings from these GWAS was of a SNP, which actually happened to be a missense variant in a loss-of-function intolerant gene, SCN2A, which was genome-wide associated with bipolar disorder in the most recent consortium bipolar GWAS. And what was really remarkable is that in this this very small sample, we really see a much stronger effect in the PISA with an odds ratio. It's actually a protective variant, a ratio of less than 0.6 compared to 0.88 in the consortium paper, which we then, when we analyze additional variants that were in tight linkages equilibrium with this initial variant, give even stronger results. And given the size of the search, you know, which was only these few hundred loci that had been significant in the genome-wide studies of the consortium, was really a very significant result. And again, I think provides a proof of concept that that one is likely to see these kind of sort of increased frequency of disease-relevant alleles in this population compared into general populations that one looks at. Again, I mentioned that admixture is an important aspect of this population, and it's important from two standpoints. One is that, you know, we were interested to know how homogeneous the population of the entire region is, and so we actually looked at a comparison of the genetic ancestry of this area, Manizales, that's the main focus of our project, and Medellin, which was the place that was the initial settlement of this region. And you can see that you know, although there's an overall similar ancestry, that there really are clearly some differences between these populations. So it does indicate that it's something that we need to be mindful of, particularly when we're looking at rare variants, given what I said earlier about the geographic clustering that we see in the Finnish population. But the other thing that we realized, and again, I think this is sort of where the admixture can actually become a really interesting tool, is that we can identify, because of the information that we have on this population, really within the overall region, areas that are really very different based on their ancestry. So if we sort of start with the presumption that the Native American component is probably more genetically restricted than the European component, we can identify the regions that have higher degrees of Native American ancestry and particularly try to focus on those regions as we expand the project. Okay, so that's sort of the last thing I want to say about the isolate aspect. And really for the remainder of the time, I want to talk about the idea that really was the primary motivation for this project, which is the genetic investigation of severe mental illness across diagnoses. And so again, the sort of structure of the project is that we're characterizing severe mental illness across diagnoses. We're also characterizing disease trajectories, which I'll also talk about, and that we do this because of the fact that we have access to really the comprehensive set of individuals with severe mental illness in an entire region. And we have this because there's a single hospital, as I mentioned, for a population of about 1 million people in the city of Manizales in a province called Caldas. And from the 70,000 electronic health records in this province, we can essentially ascertain individuals with severe mental illness agnostic to whatever diagnosis they've had. So as opposed to, let's say, deciding in advance, we're going to study this number of individuals with bipolar disorder, this number with schizophrenia, we can try to really characterize the entire population of severe mental illness because anyone who's been hospitalized has been hospitalized here. And so in addition to using the electronic health records for ascertainment, we have assessments sort of in the traditional way that this is done using diagnostic interviews. We also have a number of dimensional measures so that we can look at things like neurocognitive function. But I think most interestingly from my standpoint, we can take advantage of the extraordinary information that's present in electronic health records on 70,000 people to derive phenotypic information. And so to sort of take a step back, what is the motivation for unifying genetic studies of severe mental illness, which as I mentioned is really, in my mind, the main point of this project? Why do we want to study these disorders together rather than separately, as has been the norm? And really the reason is pretty simple, which is that although our field has separated these categories for decades, all of the evidence indicates that they really don't belong separated. Not that there aren't some distinct features that they may have, but there's an extraordinary amount of overlap in symptomatology between depression, bipolar disorder, and schizophrenia, and the results of a number of different types of analysis have shown really strong genetic correlations between these syndromes. For example, the correlation genetically in terms of common genetic variation between bipolar disorder and schizophrenia is close to 0.8. And so our hypothesis that really drives this project is that what you might call transdiagnostic dimensions, symptoms, and the phenotypes like neurocognitive function, trajectories, may better represent the biology underlying severe mental illness than the diagnoses themselves. And I'll just sort of give a couple of illustrations of this from the data that we've looked at so far in sort of the first, I think, 3,000 or so individuals that we've studied from the 8,000 that are in this current project. So one of the things that we did is that we started looking at symptoms across diagnoses, and in order to do that, we actually had to deviate from the standard practice in psychiatry, which is most diagnosis in psychiatry is accomplished by structured interviews. We don't have biological markers to make diagnosis, so we use structured interviews. And the way structured interviews are done is that they have a branching structure. So once somebody is answered positively to a screen, let's say for schizophrenia, they get asked all the questions for schizophrenia. If you don't answer positively to the screen of schizophrenia, you don't get asked about any of the symptoms that are characteristic of schizophrenia. So we thought, okay, well, we'll do those interviews according to that logic, but we'll also ask about what we consider key symptoms for everyone, regardless of how they've answered the screen. And what we see when we do this is that most of these symptoms are seen across at least two, and in some cases, across all of the different diagnostic categories. So what you can see is that many of the symptoms related to depression are seen in very high frequencies in schizophrenia, as well as in what are traditionally thought of as mood disorders. And you could look at any of these and see the same thing. And I'll just sort of give one single illustration about how the interview does not fully capture symptoms. So typically, individuals who go down a schizophrenia route in an interview will never get asked about a symptom that we would call grandiosity. It's sort of the belief that one has great powers or that there's something particularly special about one. But what we see is that when we ask these questions about grandiosity to individuals who've been diagnosed with schizophrenia, that over a quarter of them actually answer positively to these symptoms. And so what you can imagine then from the standpoint of genetics is that this is an example of a phenotype that you would never typically look at across an entire group of people with severe mental illness if you've divided it to start with on the basis of diagnoses, rather than asking the same questions of everyone. Similarly, we learn things when we look at cognitive function, and this is just a figure which shows performance on a variety of cognitive performance tasks between individuals with schizophrenia, severe bipolar disorder or bipolar 1 disorder, milder bipolar disorder or bipolar 2 disorder, major depressive disorder, and in comparison, normal controls. And what you can see, I think, more clearly at the bottom is that the individuals with severe bipolar disorder really functionally on these tests are much more similar to schizophrenia than they are to milder bipolar disorder, which is much more like major depression. And the reason why I emphasize this point is that the result of the consortium genetic studies has been that that schizophrenia and bipolar 1 disorder are highly genetically correlated, and depression and mild bipolar disorder are highly correlated. And this could be considered a potential explanation for that kind of dichotomization. And we can also see that we can relate symptoms. You know, I mentioned that we've assessed symptoms across diagnoses, and you can see that there are some results that you can relate to specific symptoms rather than diagnoses. So, for example, we see that increase in psychosis affects cognitive performance across all diagnoses. It's not a surprising finding, but again, it's one that hadn't been made before. So the last thing that I'm going to talk about, which really is in the same domain as this sort of emphasis on phenotypes for all these disorders together, is what I consider really the most exciting aspect of this, which is the use of electronic health records for phenotyping in psychiatry. And it can be used both for establishing diagnoses, for identifying dimensions, but I think most interestingly for identifying disease trajectories, which themselves are, I think, really important phenotypes. So just to sort of quickly introduce this, as I mentioned, we have access to the electronic health records in this project on 70,000 people. It's really detailed and complete information collected for now about 15 years. It's sort of remarkable how much better the electronic health records are in Colombia than in the U.S., but it's sort of one of the surprising things that we found. And again, this is sort of like a registry since it's the only hospital in this entire state. And there's really just sort of an incredible amount of information. There's, for example, 800,000 different notes written by psychiatrists in this record. There's information on medications if one's interested in doing pharmacogenetic studies and so forth. And so, as I mentioned a minute ago, we can use these both for establishing diagnoses and symptoms and for analyses of trajectories, and then something I'll just mention very briefly, for actually looking at genetics in relationship to environment, in this case through geospatial analyses. one of the things that we were interested in, because of the fact that we actually had 8,000 people that are going to be directly interviewed, and we had electronic health records for all of them, is how well do the interview diagnoses match those that we can make from the electronic health record? And the answer is they actually correspond quite well. You know, in some areas of medicine, 80% concordance wouldn't be very good, but it's actually higher than what you see if you have two different psychiatrists doing an interview on the same person. So you know, I think this is about as good as we get in our field. Many of the relevant phenotypic data are in texts, as I mentioned. There's a vast amount of text information. And so we can get information on things that may not be completely represented in interviews, for example, let's say about suicide attempts, which people may not want to talk about. And so we've established a pipeline for extracting symptom and behaviors from text. I won't really go into the details of how this is done, but it's largely based on identifying sort of keywords and sentences, which we then use to tag phenotypes, and which we've sort of evaluated to show that it gives a high degree of reproducibility. And what we found is that the performance doing this sentence level sort of phenotype designation is really excellent. We had a precision of about between 95 and 100% for some of the symptoms that we're interested in. And our next step is to evaluate phenotypes not just from sort of the highest levels of the EHR, but really digging deep into the EHR versus the interview. That's something that we're working on now. And as I mentioned a few times, we're really interested in trajectories. And this is something that has largely been ignored in psychiatric research in the last few decades, mainly because most of our research has been in sort of cross-sectional studies. But this sort of illustrates why it's so important. Switching between diagnoses is really common. And so each of these lines represents a different patient. Again, since we have 15 years worth of data, we can look at the switching of diagnoses over time. And each of these different colors represents different diagnoses that the same individual has had over time. And you can just see, looking across the entire figure, that people change their diagnoses a lot over this time. And this is sort of another way of representing it, that if you look at where people started out from their first diagnosis to their current diagnosis, there's an extraordinary amount of switching. And, you know, again, if you think about the typical way in which psychiatric genetics is done, any single point here could be the point at which the phenotype is assessed in a typical study, whereas we can sort of look not just at any one point, but at this sort of entire pattern for each individual in the project. Because one of the things that we see is that people switch in non-random ways. The thickness of each of these lines indicate the frequency with which a particular switching pattern is seen. And so here's one example of people who switch between mood disorders like depression and bipolar disorder and psychotic disorders like schizophrenia, that in most of the cases, the switching occurs through bipolar disorder. That is, even if people start out with depressive disorder, if they end up with a final diagnosis of a psychotic disorder, they've usually gone through some intermediate stage of diagnosis with bipolar disorder. And this, I think, aligns with what we know from the correlations from the large-scale genetic studies of the very high correlation between bipolar disorder and schizophrenia. So the very last thing that I want to talk about is something that, you know, I think is another really incredible advantage of this kind of electronic health record-based study, is that it enables us to look not just at genetic contributions to the phenotype, but environmental contributions. You know, and we know that for all of these phenotypes, environment plays a huge role. I like to illustrate it with these two individuals who, you know, you can see are genotypically probably identical, but their experience has led them to quite different outcomes. The reason why we don't generally study the environment in these kind of studies is that we don't usually have the data in which to do so. And one of the things that we can do here, because we have this extraordinary data that sort of ties people to different locations in this region, is that we can start doing geospatial analyses to see whether there are, for example, hot spots and cold spots, which could reflect genetics, they could reflect environment, or they could reflect both. And I'll just illustrate that here. The hospital that I've been talking about is here, and if we take substance abuse, not surprisingly, the highest frequency of individuals admitted to the hospital with substance abuse are those living in this big city where the hospital is based. You know, they are the ones who are, have most access to the hospital. But then when we look at bipolar disorder, what really surprised us is that this other community, which is some distance from the hospital, is an incredible hotspot of frequency of bipolar disorder. And why this is, we have no idea. And, you know, at some point we will learn, you know, whether there is a genetic explanation for this, an environmental explanation, or something that, you know, combines the two. So so that's where we've got to so far. I just want to, in the very last slide, talk about our next steps. One of the things that's really exciting to us is that before Thomas left the NIMH, he and his colleagues put together a funding program that was, you know, really designed for what we wanted to do, which was to undertake very large-scale genetic studies using electronic health records. So we put in an application, which it looks like it's going to be funded, to extend the study that I've just talked about to create a really large-scale psychiatric biobank in the Pisa region, which will be a cohort of 100,000 people, 50,000 severe mental illness cases, and 50,000 controls, all of whom will be both ascertained and phenotyped essentially exclusively on the basis of electronic health records. And we're hoping to start that study sometime in the next 6 months. And then in yet another study, which we hope to do, this has not yet actually been applied for, but working with several other groups, we're working on a plan to aggregate over 160,000 cases of schizophrenia and bipolar disorder from both African and Latin American ancestry to really power genetic discovery, I think on a scale, you know, not just that's been seen in non-European populations never before, but I think that they're really, in the whole field of psychiatry, has really not been seen before. And, you know, and we're extending in our part of this to several sites in Brazil and also coastal Colombia and closer to home, the very large Latin American population in Southern California. So just to conclude, you know, I hope I've convinced you that rapid generation of samples for well-powered Latin American psychiatric genetic studies is feasible. The PISA is a very populous and recently bottlenecked isolate, which we believe should be enriched for many high-frequency deleterious variants, that the electronic health record ascertainment in this population will enable a trajectory-focused transdiagnostic study of severe mental illness, and, you know, and finally, the diversification of psychiatric genetics is really now happening in a very rapid way. And so these are just the many groups that are involved in the Finnish study that I described to you very briefly, and in the Colombian project that we are now working on. So thanks very much.
Thanks, Nelson. We have time for a few questions.
This was very exciting. So my question that you found from depression to schizophrenia, where you identified they moved toward the bipolar. Did you distinguish between mild bipolar versus severe bipolar? Because you mentioned the genetic associations differ.
That comes as all bipolar cases at this point.
Because didn't you mention that?
We think they do differ, yeah. But this is sort of a very quick pass through this
And then if you some of these studies in the U.S., do you think the issues in the U.S., as you mentioned, that our electronic health records are not in place to the same?
It's not that they're not, but they're not as good as in Colombia, which I think is surprising to most people. I mean, there are a lot of electronic health, you know, most major medical centers have now had electronic health records in place for, let's say, the last 5 or 6 years. So there's a lot that can be done in the U.S. I mean, I wasn't trying to say that it can't be. I mean, no, there's I think, tremendous amount that's going to be done over the next few years everywhere in the U.S.
But the question would be how uniform they are. So if you want to compare the data and they capture different data, that might be error variance.
It will.
Oh, that would be very interesting to speak about that. But thank you. It was very fascinating.
Yeah. It's very interesting that the top hit variant you have identified is a missense variant.
Yeah.
And it is located in a loss function intolerant gene. And but it's as a protective, as indicated by the odds ratio less than one.
Right.
It's kind of how to... it's from a biological point of view, this variant is just supposed to be a risk variant.
Well, you know, I think it's an interesting question. I mean, you know, variants that have a biological function may be a risk for one thing and a protection for something else. Right, so there's nothing to say that this variant arose, you know, and has been selected for because it protects here. And I think what we now know from, you know, from studies of a number of diseases is many of the variants that are found to be enriched, you know, through sequencing studies are protective variants. The PCSK9 variant, you know, that's protective against heart disease is, you know, probably the best known. I mean, that's something that was found because, you know, it's an incredibly strong, from a biological standpoint, it's a deleterious variant. I mean, it sort of prevents the function of the gene that it's, you know, supposed to be protected in.
Yeah, so from one of the early slides that you show Manhattan plot, so that one is for the Caucasian population, right? The first Manhattan plot for...
The first Manhattan plot was for all populations, but 96% of them, I think, were Caucasian.
I'm curious, did you check the associations of this variant among other populations?
So again, that was for schizophrenia. This variant was not seen in schizophrenia for bipolar disorder. We have looked at that variant in all of the populations, including East Asian, which, you know, you might think in this Latin American population with its Native American ancestry might also show association, but it's really actually quite similar in the East Asian and the European for that particular variant.
Yeah.
Yeah. Two quick questions. So the first is, what kind of genetic analysis are you planning to do on the cohort? Are you planning to do whole genome sequencing?
That's a good question. It's part of the reason I'm here. So we're not sure yet. At the moment, we're just doing SNP genotyping, but it's always been the expectation that we will be doing exome or preferably whole genome sequencing.
Nelson has expressed a strong interest in exploring the non-coded genome before.
That's right.
And then the curiosity, did you find strong clinician effect in the EHR analysis? Did you find that they had very different ways of diagnosing patients?
No. We were very interested in that question. And
Okay, so amazingly interesting. With your geospatial data, are you pairing up with the Colombian authorities to do interventional studies in areas such as where you have the higher bipolar?
We're not yet, but that is an interest that we have. There are a lot of Colombians involved in this project. And a lot of the collaborators are those responsible for treatment.
So the question I have is twofold. One is about gender, right? You've talked about the population, but I'm not quite sure of the gender breakdown in there. So did you actually look at that and see if there were those differences? And then the second one has to do with, as you move it back toward California, the difference. So you're moving between Latin American and Hispanic cultures, but they're different. So if we talk about that, what would that look like in California, right, with the indigenous mixed with Mexican and the like, and then within group of people of African descent, right? In Brazil, you will have people of African descent as well as people of indigenous populations. So there are all those three different issues, but they play a role.
I mean, all really interesting questions. So let me try to remember that. So first about gender. So, you know, the gender breakdown that we see in Colombia is pretty similar to what's seen here. Higher frequency of schizophrenia in men, higher frequency of depression in women, and more or less equal frequency of bipolar disorder in men and women. Our project is slightly weighted towards women over men, which is, I think, just the fact that women are more willing to participate in things than men are. In terms of the different populations, you know, that I, on the last slide, the reason why I was interested in sort of going from this population in Colombia that we've been working with to both coastal population in Colombia and the Brazilian population is very specifically because of the possibility of now bringing in what I would call freeway admixture between European, African, and Native American ancestries, you know, and environments. Remarkably, the coastal Caribbean population in Colombia, which is in the city of Cartagena, you know, that many people know about from Gabriel Garcia Marquez books, is literally one third of each ancestry is the predominant mix there. So I don't know of any other place in the world that's like that. The African country, you know, I think a lot of people, again, in the U.S., people may not be aware of the enormity of the African diaspora to Brazil. I think something like 50 to 60% of all, you know, all the Africans who were transported from Africa to the Americas were transported specifically to Brazil. So both the size of the population is, you know, dwarfs the African population anywhere else in the Americas, and also the places where, you know, where the population derives from are, you know, it's not just the regions of Ghana, Senegal, and so forth that, you know, that the North American, African-American population comes from, but Mozambique, Angola, and, you know, many other places. So, I think there are a lot of things we'll learn, but also, you know, going back to my point about health disparities, you know, the population of Brazil is a population of 200 million. It's almost the size of the United States. I don't think that there's really been a single well-powered genetic study of any disease in Brazil. I mean, it's really amazing to me.
Okay. Hi, from the last slide, I assume that your study design is a case control, right? Which means you are mainly focused on the inherited variants. So I'm very curious about the de novo mutations, which is based on the trial data.
Yeah.
So could you please comment on the design?
It's true that we probably don't have the optimal design for de novo variants. People here, I think, have largely been interested in neurodevelopmental diseases within, you know, the space of neuropsychiatric disease, which are more likely, I think, to have had sort of large effect in ovo variation. I don't think there's that much evidence, let's say, for its effect in bipolar disorder and depression. The other thing is that we do have the opportunity, since we have so much involvement with these populations, to potentially change to a trio design sometime in the future if we wanted to get a different study.
Thank you.
Trio studies are making the presumption that there are going to be variants of really large effect. And as Thomas knows, because he funded them, we spent a long time doing family-based designs for these adult disorders, particularly bipolar disorder, without finding anything. I think that,
means the design is really depends on the mechanisms of the disease.
I think it does. Yeah. I mean, it has to.
Thank you.